There is geometry in the humming of the strings. There is music in the spacing of the spheres. In the annals of human history, few concepts have kindled the imagination as profoundly as the celestial spheres. This grandiose cosmological model serves as a testament to our ancestors' ingenuity, a portal into their perception of the universe's intricate divine harmony. Our voyage into this celestial paradigm begins in ancient Greece. The Greeks could see in the heavens above them the cycles of planets and stars that seemed to regulate time, preside over the day and the night, and thus dictate the rhythmic movements of beings down here on Earth. The unfolding dance of the celestial spheres was the very order that ruled the world. The explicit rational mapping of the celestial spheres began in the fertile mind of Anaximander, a Greek visionary of the early 6th century BC. In his cosmogony, the entire cosmos emanates from an original sphere of fire, birthing rings that will become the foundation of cosmic movements. The celestial bodies find their existence within tubular rings of fire, forming chariot-like wheels, pivoting on the Earth's central axis. The sun and moon, circular vents in these fiery rims, dance alongside the myriad of stars, creating a continuous spherical shell embracing the Earth. According to Anaximander, this Earth is isolated in space, and the sky is a complete sphere in the center of which is located, unsupported, our cylinder, the Earth, situated at an equal distance from all the points of the sky. Anaximenes, a disciple of Anaximander, furthered this celestial tale. Stars, sun, moon, and planets, all crafted from the ethereal flame, found their place within a revolving crystal sphere. Anaximenes envisioned the fixed stars as studs on this celestial sphere, while the sun, moon, and planets rode the currents of air, akin to leaves fluttering in the cosmic breeze. In the wake of Anaximenes, echoes of spherical cosmology resonated through the minds of Pythagoras, Xenophanes, and Parmenides, who envisioned a universe sculpted in the perfect form of a sphere. Pythagoras, the great integrator of mathematics and cosmology, once mused, "For those who are able to discern order in this movement, who can partake of the primordial and mental things, numbers and proportions, the sight of the firmament and the luminaries moving across it is a beautiful sight." In the 4th century BC, Plato, disciple of Socrates and founder of the Academy, presented his vision of the cosmos in the dialogue Timaeus. Plato embraced spherical elegance, but diverged from earlier thought in that he didn't conceive the celestial bodies as rotating wheels or rims. Plato's imagination reached for a more abstract and mathematical elegance. The spheres followed geometrically perfect rings. The circle, in Plato's eyes, was the most perfect and harmonious geometric shape, embodying divine symmetry and balance. For Plato, the soul is drawn to the beauty of the heavens because it longs to conform to their primordial perfection. In his words, "Astronomy compels the soul to look upwards and leads us from this world to another." Development of the model continued with Plato's student, Eudoxus, who imagined concentric spheres rotating around the Earth, with each of these celestial bodies encapsulated within its own celestial nest. It was a mesmerizing ballet of spheres, each planet tethered to its own set, creating a celestial harmony. Callippus, in modification, added his brushstroke to the cosmic canvas, introducing a grand total of 33 spheres that housed the celestial bodies. The philosophical giant Aristotle, in his Metaphysics, embraced and expanded upon Plato and Eudoxus' ideas. the Earth stood at the heart of the universe, surrounded by interconnected spheres, numbering no less than 55. Each sphere, a divine realm, moved by a celestial deity, choreographed the dance of the planets. The movement of these spheres was thought to be driven by spiritual entities, unmoved movers, as Aristotle termed them. These entities were not gods in a traditional sense, but rather intellectual agents that imparted motion to the spheres without themselves being moved. This concept was not only an astronomical explanation, but also a deeply philosophical one, suggesting a universe governed by a hierarchy of divine intelligences, each responsible for the motion of its respective sphere. Aristotle envisioned these spheres as ethereal, made of an unchanging fifth element, the ether. The ether was the essence of the divine, immutable and perfect, a stark contrast to the constant change observed on Earth. Aristotle's universe is geocentric, with Earth at its immutable core. The Earth is part of the sublunar realm, which is constantly changing and becoming, while the spheres are of the supralunar realm of pure intellect. This arrangement places the moon in the nearest sphere, followed by the planets in the order of Mercury, Venus, the Sun, Mars, Jupiter, and Saturn, each in their respective crystalline orbs. Beyond these planetary spheres lay the sphere of fixed stars, immovable and eternal. This geocentric model suggested a cosmos where Earth was not just physically, but also metaphysically central. The celestial spheres encapsulated the ancients' quest to harmonize the observable motions of the heavens with a philosophically satisfying model that echoed the perfection they perceived in the natural world. Aristotle's model, further refined by Ptolemy and later adapted by Copernicus, became the cornerstone of medieval and Renaissance cosmology. Ptolemy, building on Aristotle's foundations, introduced the concepts of epicycles and deference to account for the irregular movements of planets, notably their retrograde motion. In his model, each planet moved in a small circle, the epicycle, which in turn moved along a larger circular path, the deferent. This system, while more complex, maintained the essential idea of circular motion, crucial to the philosophical view of a harmonious and ordered cosmos. Ptolemy's Almagest, a comprehensive treatise on his astronomical theories, provided detailed mathematical explanations for these movements and would remain the foundational text for cosmologists all the way until Copernicus, Kepler, and Galileo. It would also have an extremely central role in the development of astrology and zodiac models. Ptolemy has taught countless generations to gaze with amazement at the stars. Let us now in turn be inspired by these profound words of his. I know that I am mortal by nature and ephemeral, but when I trace at my pleasure the windings to and fro of the heavenly bodies, I no longer touch earth with my feet. I stand in the presence of Zeus himself and take my fill of ambrosia, food of the gods. The profound celestial thought of the ancient Greeks reminds us that it is the sense of wonder and beauty that ignites our quest to unravel the secrets of the cosmos. If we look up at the celestial spheres, in their majestic and orderly procession, we behold, playing out across the vault of the heavens, a cosmic dance of divine proportions